Oliver Wyman Senior Advisor Patrick Walsh and partner Dennis Santare sit down in this three-part video series to explore various aspects of sustainment within the aerospace and defense industry. Watch and learn why sustainment is a combat enabler, what good looks like for sustainment, and finally, the recommended approach for companies and the government going forward. Patrick Walsh is a retired four-star admiral, and Dennis Santare has served as an officer and aviator in the United States Marine Corps.
Now, we've talked about sustainment as a combat enabler. We've also talked about the power of government and commercial partnerships in improving aircraft readiness levels through bringing the best of both worlds together. There are some benefits and there are also some pitfalls in executing that. And today I'd like to focus on your recommendations for the path forward and the tactics available to these entities in making these partnerships happen. Some might say that it's difficult to do at all. There are these pitfalls, including reconciling corporate profit and the appetite for profit with the fact that we have these national depots and we have these organizations that do maintenance within the government. And so there's natural competition there. There's the 50-50 rule, for example, which mandates that not more than 50% of funding allocated to maintenance and repair of our national assets be awarded outside of the government, in essence, to third-party commercial entities. So what are your recommendations at a high level for making sure that both parties come to that table and the equation works?
I think we start with the depot. I think the depot discussion is critically important. This is a national asset. Leaders have made the decision that we will have maintenance and repair capability available to us 24/7, regardless of the economic condition, whether it's an upturn or a downturn in the country. It'll be available if there's a hostile event that takes place anywhere around the world, and we have that reliance on skilled artisans to be there and to be available for our aviation as well as our shipborne community. I think we take the perspective for the original equipment manufacturers to look closely at ways that they can make those depots more efficient and more effective to deliver products on time and on cost. First time quality, hugely important in terms of what the depot provides to the fleet. I think there's teaming opportunities for the OEMs, and I think there's opportunities for the depots to really benefit from that close relationship.
One of the things we're hearing lately is around the concept of intellectual property and the requirement of the OEM to protect their investment in research and development, and in essence, playing a big role in sustainment of the platforms that they've designed and produced. Obviously, that's some natural tension with the government who wants access to that IP, right, so that they can use it in their own repairs, within the depots, et cetera, and also open up competition to third parties, other commercial entities who might want to do that work. So what are your thoughts about the OEMs and their need to protect their IP?
I think you've described the problem and the challenge as well as the dilemma very accurately. It's a formula for a stalemate because the government has its perspective on a purpose-built aircraft that's designed to be a fighter. The OEM has a real proprietary interest that has the keys to the future success of that company tied up in those data rights. So the real issue is that the only way that we can navigate the space? And I think there's examples where representatives of both industry and government have found a way to be successful. I'll use the 117 engine overhaul contract as an example at Warner Robins, where the depot did a lot of the labor-intensive work, and Pratt did the complex component overhaul associated with the engine. You put those two together and you end up with an outcome that's on cost, on schedule, and delivers first-time quality. That to me is an example of how we should team in the future.
The OEMs need to be involved. Time and time again, we hear from warfighters that they're challenged with getting the right part on the right shelf at the right time for the right aircraft and making that happen. And I think the OEMs need to be a big part of that in terms of the supply chain and the aftermarket. But the government has to play a role too in bringing both sides to bear. What are some recommendations for the government side of this?
I think it would be interesting from the government perspective to compare and contrast what happens when they make a long-term commitment and what happens when they don't. When they make a long-term commitment, now industry can turn to its suppliers and can give forecasts and can give schedules and then regulate cost to make it more effective, more efficient, and to deliver first-time quality on time. When government doesn't deliver that kind of commitment to industry, then industry is stuck having to react, oftentimes at great cost and overrun, and potential late deliveries. So the best perspective that we should offer here for recommendations to government is to make that long-term commitment to industry.
In particular, when you think about the depots alone, you know, in on the Navy side, 6,500 Navy sailors and Marines, plus 9,500 of their civilian counterparts in terms of artisans, work in our Navy depots on upwards of $4 billion worth of assets. So it's important to have that side of the equation here as well. What do you think are some of the key pitfalls when bringing those two sides of the equation together?
You've just described the level of commitment that the government makes to the depot every day. I think a pitfall would be trying to maneuver work outside of that workforce. Mm-hmm. Instead, I think a better use of the OEN's time and focus would be ways that they can team and help support the depot, whether it be training or capability gaps that exist within the depot, or other ways that the depot can be more efficient and to deliver on schedule and on cost. That sort of teaming arrangement would allow for a better partnership and certainly deliver a better product to the warfighter.
It's all about better partnerships and making the warfighter successful. Pat, really enjoyed the conversation again, and you know, it's been wonderful talking to you. Thank you so much for your time.
Dennis, thank you, and thank you for the focus on sustainment today.